In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, for God, Amen. Tonight, through the grace of God, we will study together chapter 6 from the book of Acts. This chapter is a very important chapter in the whole scripture, because in this chapter we read about the ordination of the deacons, the ordination of the first 7 deacons in the church. The summary of the chapter, there was a complaint from the Grecians, and because of this complaint, the church decided to appoint 7 deacons. Also, we read in the chapter that many of the priests converted to Christianity. Many of the Jewish priests converted to Christianity. We also read about St. Stephen and the power of God that was working with him and how he performed many miracles and wonders. And there was a controversy between St. Stephen with the Jews, and they charged him with blasphemy, and they brought him before the Sanhedrin. This is the summary of the chapter, and let's start reading it verse by verse. Verse 1. Now, in those days, when the number of the disciples was multiplying, there arose a complaint against the Hebrews by the Hellenists, because their widows were neglected in the daily distribution. In those days, maybe after some years from the Pentecost, and now the number of the believers multiplied. Who are the Hellenists? Hellenists are Jewish people who live outside Jerusalem in Greece. Like we are Egyptian, but we live here in America. So the Hellenists are not Greek by birth, but or by race, but they are Jewish people who live outside Jerusalem in Greece, and now maybe they returned back to Jerusalem and they became Christian. The Jewish people who live in Jerusalem consider themselves superior to the Jewish people who live outside Jerusalem. And maybe that's why they neglected the Hellenists in the daily distribution. What's the daily distribution? As we read in chapter 2, that everybody took according to his need, and nobody was in need. And definitely the widows were dependent people. At the time, women were not working. So the widow definitely were in need. And every day, they used to go to the disciples or the apostles and take their needs from them. And because the number was multiplied, maybe there was no much attention was given to the widows of the Hellenists. And when they found that these widows are neglected in the daily distribution, they made a complaint to the apostles. And here, we didn't find the apostles became offensive. Or they strive to justify and say everything is okay. Why are you complaining? No, they didn't act in this way. They started the complaint in a very objective way, and they start to find a solution, as they made a solution in order to satisfy the people. So I can say, every time and everywhere, because we are human beings, we will not be perfect in our service, in our ministry. And we expect complaint to come. And when we hear any complaint, we should take it in an objective way and study the complaint and try to find a solution to the complaint. And in this way, everybody will be satisfied. And this is the responsibility of the servants of the church, like the apostles, like the clergy. So here, we know that the number of the disciples multiplied, and because the number multiplied, some widows of the Hellenists were neglected in the daily distribution, and this complaint went to the apostles. Let us see how the apostles solved this. Verse 2. Then the 12 summoned the multitude of the disciples and said, "It is not desirable that we should leave the word of God and serve the tables." And here the disciples or the apostles were very, very clear about their mission, their ministry. Their ministry is to pray and to preach the word of God. And they didn't want any distraction. That's why they started to choose lay people and to appoint a rank in the church called the rank of the servant, the deacons, because the deacon, the word deacon in Greek means a servant. And here I like to describe the triangle of the priesthood. We have three ranks, the bishop and the priest and the deacon. The priest should be responsible for the spiritual affair of the church. The deacons should be responsible for the administrative affairs of the church. And both of them should report to the bishop. That is the triangle. The bishop and the priest and the deacon, priest responsible for the spiritual affairs of the church, deacons responsible for the administrative affairs of the church, and both of them report to the bishop. But here I want to emphasize how the 12 made it very clear it is not desirable that we should be distracted by administrative issues, by serving the people, and we need the word of God. Our calling is to preach the word of God. Our calling is the spiritual affair of the church. And the word 12 means that Matthias was included, because they chose Matthias to replace Judas. And this means Matthias was accepted as a full apostle among the 12 apostles. Verse 3. "Therefore, brethren, seek out from among you 7 men of good reputation, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business or over this service." So, in order for the apostles to dedicate their time for the spiritual ministry and for preaching the word of God, they decided to appoint 7 because it is a number of perfection, 7 deacons, 7 servants, in order to be responsible for distributing the daily food for the needy. And here they make, I can say, two requirements or three requirements. Actually, there are two requirements. People of good reputation and full of wisdom and full of respect. Why is it two requirements? Three. Because you cannot have a good reputation and you cannot be wise unless you are full of the Holy Spirit. So the message here, we need to choose people who are of good reputation and wise. And in order to find these people, they have to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Filled with the Holy Spirit means they bear the fruit of the Spirit in them. They are known of their honesty. They are known of their faithfulness. I can't trust them with the money of the church, with the distribution. They are faithful. And wise, in order to be prudent, understanding, know how to distribute wisely. And if you remember when the Lord spoke about the steward, He said, who is the faithful and wise steward? These are the two main characteristics. Here we need their faithful, good reputation, and wise. And I usually explain it this way. If you have business and you want to appoint a manager to this business, you will look for a faithful and wise manager. Faithful in order not to steal your money, and wise in order to be able to make a profit. If you choose him faithful but not wise, then yes, he's faithful. He will not steal your money, but he cannot make any profit. If you choose him wise and not faithful, he will make a lot of profit, but he will steal it from you. In the same way, we as a steward, God expects from us two things: to be wise and faithful. Wise in order to make profit for the glory of God. Faithful not to steal this profit to ourselves, but to render it to God. And here there is participation of the people. They call the believers to seek out from among you, seven men, nomination. That's why when we choose by the word of deacon, we ask you to nominate people. We don't appoint them, we follow the biblical order here. You nominate, and then we choose from those whom you are nominating. Even in the priesthood, you know, the people has to approve the candidate for the priesthood, or even the bishop. They have to approve him first. As the apostle said, seek out from among you seven men of good reputation, full of good spirit and wisdom, who may appoint over this business. Appoint means ordain. Appoint here means ordain. Ordaining them. And we will see how the ordination will be done. Ordination will be done by prayer and laying of hands. And until now, when we ordain deacon or a priest, we ordain them by prayer, laying of hand, and the breath of the Holy Spirit, that the Lord raised the face of the disciples and gave them the Holy Spirit. Verse 4, but we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. Here is the goal. We want to appoint deacons in order for us to dedicate ourselves continually to prayer and ministry of the word. This is our calling as clergy, as priests. We need to dedicate our life to prayer, like worship, liturgy, praises, and preaching the word. Then it is the responsibility of the deacons to help in the administrative. And I want you to hear to notice that they did not appoint deacons so that the apostles will have rest and they relax. They didn't say this. They said actually, appoint deacon because there is another calling, another mission you are responsible for, which is the prayer and the ministry of the word. Verse 5, and the saying pleased the whole multitude. And here is the wisdom. When there is a complaint, I should find a solution that possibly pleases everybody. If I find a solution to please everybody, then actually I'm successful in resolving this conflict. And here I want you to notice that the apostles did not let the complaint to go for so many weeks or months or years. They immediately attended to the complaint, made a resolution, and everybody was pleased, everybody was happy. And the saying pleased the whole multitude. And they chose 7 persons. Stephen, a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit. And actually in Acts chapter 6 and 7, we will know more about St. Stephen. St. Stephen became the first martyr and became the archdeacon or the head of the deacons. And full of faith. Full of faith means he was a believer, a Christian, full of the Holy Spirit, faithful. And full of the Holy Spirit. And full of the Holy Spirit. As I told you, you cannot be wise, you cannot be faithful, unless you are filled with the Holy Spirit. And Philip. This Philip is different than Philip, one of the 12 apostles. This Philip is commonly referred to as Philip the Evangelist. And we will see in chapter 8 how he did amazing ministry in Samaria. And after this, the Lord actually chose him to go and to preach to the Ethiopian eunuch. Then we read in the book of Acts about Philip, that at the end he lived and labored or ministered as Caesarea, as we read in Acts chapter 21, verse 8. At the end he lived and labored as Caesarea. Then the other names, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, Nicholas. Some people said that Nicholas is the one who's mentioned in the book of Revelation about the heresy of Nicolaitan. So maybe it is the same Nicholas actually who started this heresy. He was one of the 7, but he drifted away from the faith. And they refer to him a proselyte from Antioch. What does it mean, proselyte from Antioch? The word proselyte means a person who is Gentile, not of Jewish origin. So this man was from Antioch. He was a Gentile, not Jewish man, from Antioch. But he was converted to Judaism and being circumcised. And after this, he became Christian. So when you read the word proselyte in the New Testament, proselyte means a person who was not a Jewish, but converted to Judaism and being circumcised. And as for Nicholas, he became actually Christian later on, was chosen one of the 7 deacons. Verse 6, whom they sent before the apostles. Like when we did the deacons, they come before the altar and the bishop, they sent for the bishop to ordain him. And when they had prayed, they laid hands on them. This is how we ordain. You know, in the ordination, the bishop first pray, say some prayers, and then he lays the hand on the candidate. So to ordain, we ordain by laying hands and by prayer. Usually, the ordination happens either after the reading of the Book of Acts or either after the reconciliation prayer. The ordination of bishops and patriarchs are done after the reading of Acts. Why? Because the ordination of the bishop and patriarch are the continuation of the apostles. That's why they are ordained after the reading of the Book of the Acts of the Apostles. Deacons and priests are ordained after the reconciliation prayer, because their ministry is ministry of reconciliation. That's why the deacons and the priests are ordained after the prayer of reconciliation, because their ministry is ministry of reconciliation. Now we have several ranks in deaconate. Chanter or psaltos means the deacon who chants. Ognostos or reader means those who read. Subdeacon or deacon assistant, who assists the full deacon in his ministry. Then the full deacon, and then the archdeacon, which is the head of the deacon. So we have psaltos, psalms from the word psalm, which means a chanter. Ognostos means leader, subdeacon, deacon assistant, then the full deacon, and the archdeacon, the head of the deacons. Unfortunately, all the ranks of the deaconate are not working properly during these days. For example, chanter should chant only. But now we ordain the psalms, and from the day he is ordained, he can read and can serve at the altar, and this is not right. Only those who are of Moses' reader should read, but unfortunately, we allow the psalms to read. Only the full deacon should serve inside the altar, but now we allow the psalms and of Moses to serve inside the altar. And the deacon who is serving inside the altar should be assisted by the subdeacon to assist him in preparing the altar. And then there has to be an archdeacon actually to organize and supervise all the deacon ministry. And the deacon not only serve, the full deacon not only serve at the altar, but as I explained, he should be responsible for all the administrative affairs of the church. As St. Stephen was preaching the word of God, so he has a liturgical ministry, and besides his liturgical ministry, he was in charge of the administrative affairs of the church. And actually, I was thinking, if in our diocese we start to allow only some psalms to chant, only the readers, the ordinances to read, only some deacon and deacon to serve and guide the altar. But I have a concern, because this is not followed everywhere. So people will come and start to compare, why the psalms are allowed to serve in this church but not serving here? Why the readers are allowed to be inside the altar but not here? And the conflict here is that unfortunately the wrong begins at home. And when we want to correct it, actually people will complain about what's right. But as St. Paul said, God is God of order. And I hope one day that we can keep the original order of the deacon. Also, the full deacon and archdeacon should be full-time consecrated. They They cannot work and serve as full deacons. And they also are vested in black robes, like the priests. The full deacon and the archdeacon should be fully consecrated to the service of the Lord. Verse 7. Then the word of God spread. Wow! Because now there are deacons who are responsible for the administrative. And the apostles dedicated more time to the ministry of the word and prayer. That's why the word of God spread. But if the apostles were busy with the administrative affairs of the church, this would be hindrance to spreading the word of God. And the numbers of the disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem. Disciples mean those who believe in Christ. Why can we call disciples? Because they are disciples of Christ. So when you read in the book of Acts, what are disciples? Disciples means Christian, disciples of Christ. And many, many of the priests were obedient to the faith. So even priests from the Jewish tradition, now they converted to Christianity and became Christian. And I want you to know that there was a great number of priests. In Ezra chapter 2, verse 36 to 39, we read that there was at that time of Ezra 4,289 priests who returned from Babylon. So we expect that this number of priests multiplied than 4,289. And many of these priests now became Christian. Obedient to the faith means obedient to the Christian faith. They believe in Christ. Verse 8. And Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and signs among the people. So, not only he was successful in his ministry as archdeacon, but also God used him in order to perform miracles and to perform wonders and signs among the people. In the ordination, the Holy Spirit descended upon the candidate. So the Holy Spirit descended upon St. Stephen and the other six deacons. And because they received the grace of the Holy Spirit through this ordination, now they become full of power, the power of the Holy Spirit, and God performed miracles, signs, and wonders on their hands. And full of faith means he was a godly man. He was confident in God. His faith was alive, not dead faith, not a theoretical faith. He lived what he believed. He lived what he believed. Verse 9. But do you think that Satan will see the church is growing, the number of disciples multiplying, the word of God is spreading, and Satan will be silent? No. We expect with any growth, any progress in the service, we expect also that Satan will attack. This is what happened here. Verse 9, then arose some from what is called the synagogue of the freedmen. Cyrenians, Alexandrian, and those from Cilicia and Asia. Who are the freedmen? As you know, some people, many Jews, actually thousands of Jews, were taken captive and sold into slavery by Pompey in 63 before Christ. So, either these people or their children got freed later on. So they called themselves the freedmen, those who were freed from the city and they made a synagogue for themselves. Actually, there were many synagogues in Jerusalem. In the Talmud, we read that during the time of the first church, there was 480 synagogues in Jerusalem. 480 synagogues in Jerusalem. So, that's the first one. Sirenian also group of the Jewish people who lived there, and now they returned to Jerusalem and they had their own synagogue, the synagogue of the Sirenian. Alexandria, also Jews who lived in Egypt, in Alexandria, and then they returned back and they made their own synagogue. Synagogue of Alexandria means Jewish people who live in Egypt. Cilicia, those were from Cilicia. Cilicia actually is the place where St. Paul was born, because Tarsus, the birthplace of St. Paul, was part of Cilicia. So in this synagogue, we have St. Paul in this synagogue, and we know that the synagogue attended the trial of St. Stephen. So he was a member in this synagogue of Cilicia, and as you know, St. Paul was a disciple of the Gamaliel. And St. Paul attended this trial and was one of those opponents of St. Stephen. And Asia here doesn't refer to the continent of Asia, but Asia here refers to the province, the Roman province of Asia Minor, which Ephesus was its capital. If you visit Turkey, you will find, you know, Ephesus, which was the capital of a province, a Roman province called Asia. So these synagogues, the freedmen, Cyrenian, Alexandria, Cilicia, and Asia, were disputing with St. Stephen. And as I told you, St. Paul, or his name was before Saul, was one of these people. Why they were disputing with St. Stephen? They were disputing who St. Stephen started to preach Christ. And all of these people were Jewish people. And they did not believe that Christ is the Messiah. They did not believe in the resurrection of Christ. That's why they were disputing with St. Stephen. But St. Stephen, who is full of the Holy Spirit, as the Lord promised us that he will give us mouth and wisdom, that nobody can contradict or resist. That's why they could not resist or contradict the wisdom of St. Stephen, as we read in verse 10. And they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he spoke. Wisdom and spirit means these words are not his own words, but the words of the spirit of his mouth, because he was filled with the Holy Spirit. When you are filled with the Holy Spirit, nobody can resist the wisdom. It's not a human wisdom, but it is a divine wisdom. Verse 7. Then they secretly induced men to say, "We have heard speak blasphemous words against Moses and God." And until now, when people cannot resist, cannot reply wisely, they turn to attack. In any dispute, if you are making your case wisely and the person in front of you starts to attack you, this means he cannot resist your reason or your logic. Once a person cannot resist the logic or the reason or the wisdom, he turned to attack. And we see That's what happened with Saint Stephen. When they were unable to resist the wisdom, what they did? They induced secretly men to attack. Until now, we see this is happening. When people cannot resist the wisdom, secretly, they conspire and devise plans to attack. Secretly induced men to attack. Attack Saint Stephen. And they said, we have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and God. Definitely they switch and twisted the word of Saint Stephen. Because Saint Stephen was preaching that the law of Moses could not save the people. That's why God sent his son Jesus Christ to save us by the grace. And the law disciplined us until Christ. And the law was simple to the old covenant vanished, as St. Paul explained in Hebrew chapter 8. And now there is a new covenant based on grace and truth. So they twisted these words and they said, we heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and against God. Against Moses, because definitely spoke against how the law of Moses did not save the people. And God, because when he said God sent his son to the world and Jesus is God, they considered this blasphemy. Because they did not believe that Jesus is God. Verse 12. And they stirred up the people, the elders and the scribes, and they came upon him, seized him, and brought him to the council. The second way, as I told you, when a person cannot resist the wisdom, number one, he starts to attack. Number two, he starts to spread rumors among the people and to stir the people against, you know, the person whom he wants to attack. That's exactly what happened to Stephen. They attacked him and they stirred the people against him. They stirred the people. People, elders, scribes, everyone against him. So they seized him and brought him to the council. The council did the Sanhedrin. Why? To try him, to examine him, to test him. They also set up false witnesses who said, that's the third method. False witnesses who said, this man does not cease to speak blasphemous words against this holy place and the law. So the first method to attack. Second method, to steal the people, to spread rumors in order to steal the people. Third method, they bring false witnesses. People who do not say the truth. To bear false witness against Saint Stephen. And they said, this man, Saint Stephen, does not cease to speak blasphemous words against the holy place and the law. Holy place is a temple. Definitely Saint Stephen was preaching the destruction of the temple, as the Lord told them in Matthew chapter 24. As he considered this, he is speaking blasphemy against the temple. And again in the law, definitely Saint Stephen spoke how the Lord did not save the people. And that's why God replaced the old covenant with the new covenant. But he could not accept this. Verse 14, for we have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth will destroy this place and change the customs which Moses delivered to us. Get this twisting here. Jesus of Nazareth will destroy this place? No. It is their rebellion against God that destroyed the place. The Lord told them, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how many times I wanted to gather your children as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you refuse. Your house will be desolate. So why the house was destroyed? Why the temple was destroyed? Because of their rebellion. Not because Jesus destroyed the temple. But then we said Stephen was preaching about the destruction of Jerusalem and was giving them warning that the temple will be destroyed, which was fulfilled in 70 AD. And changing the custom which Moses delivered to us, definitely, because this custom was symbols. Circumcision was simple for baptism. All the sacrifices were simple for the Holy Eucharist. So he was not changing. Actually, he was preaching the fulfillment of these customs. Because circumcision was fulfilled by baptism. Sacrifices was fulfilled by the Holy Eucharist. But instead of saying he was preaching the fulfillment of the customs, they said, no, he was changing the customs which Moses delivered to us, twisting here of the hands. And all who sat in the council looked steadfastly at him. Why? They wanted to see what was his reaction to this accusation. Now this man is standing at the Sanhedrin among all these synagogues, accused falsely that he blasphemes against God, against Moses, against the holy place, against the law. And the punishment of blasphemy, stoning. So he would be stoned, he would be killed. So they looked steadfastly at his face to see how was his reaction? And maybe they were expecting to see St. Stephen afraid, crying, shaking, so angry because of this false accusation. Sometimes when people falsely accuse us, we became so angry. But how we found him? And they saw his face as the face of an angel. Godly people, people who are filled with the Holy Spirit, even when they are falsely accused, even when they are charged with blasphemy, even when they are condemned to death, because God is within them, their face will be shining like an angel. And I'm sure St. Paul, when he was sitting in this council and looked at St. Stephen, I believe that this face, the shining face, the angelic face of Saint Stephen was one of the goods that pierced the heart of Saint Paul. But until this moment, Saint Paul's heart was hardened. That's why he did not believe. And when the Lord appeared to him, he told him, it is difficult for you to kick against the goods. One of his quotes was the face of St. Stephen. That's why in his letters he referred to St. Stephen. Because he judged him, he condemned him to death, and actually he kept the cross of the people who stoned St. Stephen. What happened in the trial? This is actually what we read in Acts chapter 7. Glory be to God forever and ever. Any comments or questions on the chapter? I'm going to do some review questions about the chapter.
Questions and questions. a multiple choice question. So, so the first question is, what initiated the need for the deacon's ordination in this chapter? What initiated the need for deacon's ordination? Is it the increase in the disciples' number, or the disciples were tired of service, or trying to find a job for which to be ordained? Which one do we say? A, the increase in the disciples' number. Okay. So next one, very good. The second one, how many deacons were to be ordained? On the bottom, number three, what specifications would they look for in these deacons? For good reputation, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, cool, funny, and beautiful voice.
Jesus, obey.
Now, love of God the Father, the grace of His Holy Begotten Son, our Lord and God and Savior Jesus Christ, can you act for the Holy Spirit be with you all? Go in peace, and the peace of the Lord be with you all. Let the Lord have a good day, and the Lord have a good day, and the Lord have a good day, and the Lord have a good day.